Well, hello. Welcome to Spoken Word Saturday's mashup. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Eleanor Shaw and I'm the founder and director at People Speak Up. Spoken Word Saturday is an event, a gathering, a place for people to come together and celebrate the spoken word. We're usually based at the Furnace Fach at the Furnace Theatre in Llanelli, but this morning I'm here on my morning walk. Over the last couple of weeks, I invited our Spoken Word community to send in an audio clip or a video clip to share with us what they're feeling right now. So please sit back, listen up, and enjoy our monthly offering of Spoken Word Saturday. A Zen Koan. A long time ago, a university professor visited a Japanese master at his home to inquire about Zen. They sat together, cross-legged on the wooden floor, whilst the master started to serve tea. He poured his visitor's cup full, and he kept pouring and pouring and pouring. The professor watched this in amazement, until he could no longer restrain himself, and he said, "It's over full. Please, please, no more will go in." The Zen master said, "Like this cup, you are full of your own opinions and speculations. How can I show you Zen unless you empty your cup?" So, in this time of the unknown, we are together in knowing that we don't know.
Us as people thinking, what now, what next? A sense of worry or wonder. Neither of us know but to wait for this thunder to pass. Kicking ourselves over what we can't control, but maybe it's just the flow of how it's meant to be. Other than panic and pain, let's connect and create. We may feel alone or lost, we can help one another, reach out, recharge, rethink. Not one of us are better than the next, and a time like this will show it. Let's learn, build, explore, and be. But above all, you're not alone, and it's not I, it's we.
Dear NHS, damn right I'm gonna complain about this service sold us free in a state of disarray. I've worked since I was 13, my forefathers built this, lost their lungs, my grandfather lost his legs. Please don't cancel my op again and expect me to suck it up, to not feel the need to cry for all the times that you've cocked up. On occasion you've got things right, but right now it's hard to see, sat in a waiting room, no spare seat, 7 of us waiting for beds to be ready. 2 years I've waited for this op, 2 years before that to see a doctor with some kindness and sense willing to take me seriously. My mother was gaslit for 36 months about a stent left inside her body, sat on her big toe, bang on a nerve, aged her 20 years in 3. Doctors, consultants, nurses, professors all deemed her loopy, telling her it's all in her mind, and all the while she was bang on the money. She's worked full time since she was 15 because her father died. She's paid for every bit of help she's needed. NHS, you are not a free ride. You are collapsing because of governments, not because of people. Bombs and wrongs are not on my list, and I'm an accountant who can reason. The way outside on the wall is screaming, girl, don't waste your time. This ward is in absolute chaos. Your surgery is 3 days behind. So run, trust your gut, it's never let you down. You can see sense in your mind's eye, and the stench of grub, the clinking of cups, say run, girl, go get your chips and pie. Because you're hangry and you can't think straight no more, not eating nothing since last night. This ward is in chaos, everybody knows it. They might be trying, but this isn't right. I'm taking it back, all of it back. There are people in here dying. Families on the finest of threads, all in the wings waiting. Goodbyes, hellos, will her hair grow back when she passes over? Did she say every last bit of her script before leaving her lover, her daughter? Their sickness sits like a greasy fog. We could write all of our names on their steamed mirror. And the social aspects of your world can't help now. No more ever more delirious filters. 3. Could I be a nurse? Could I really care? Could I change bags of piss? Could I wash crusty hair? Could I hold people's hands and tell them truth and lies? Could I leave it at work, watching people die? Could I stand on my feet when the floor is falling in? Could I keep a straight face when internally freaking? Could I listen properly to my head and my heart? If I was a nurse, where on earth would I start? 4. I thought of Helen today. By my side that time, I was having secrets removed. She taught me kindness, art and values. We later fell out over boys and money. My partner had places to be, well, they cut my other secrets out. Screamed at me in the car on the way home, you're a twat. I thought of Helen today, of how she stayed the whole time, holding my hand.
In a bard, take a walk on the mild side. Onomatopoetically crunch across assonantal sand and stand hand in consonantal hand with sibilant streams. Sunder, sudden, sudden sadness. Then surrender to verse or vice versa. See and be beside a seemingly seething, seesawing, sea-seen. Mill amidst this fancy fantasy when serendipity summons serenity. Figuratively put adversity to the sword using anagrammatical words. For a homophonic spell, dispel discombobulation by resurrecting recollections of halcyon days, days. Honor your inner bard within similes as alacritous as bubbling spume, while babbling aboard your bubbling boat. Entranced, embrace becoming balm. Float high on loitering letter-littered tides. Adopt and adapt an all-alliterative argo. Palindromically pop unto dreamy uplands.
I miss places and spaces and faces. What does our future hold? No one can tell us for sure, or our ideas start to unfold. Some good, some bad, some funny, some sad. Who knows what will be? Just smile and try your hardest. C'est la vie, c'est la vie, c'est la vie.
You know, I often wonder what goes on in the minds of some folk. There's them what just gets on with it and behaves like normal, like me. Then there's them what don't know how to treat others and have no idea about respect. I tell you, two of these people come round to my place recently. There I was sitting, minding my own business, which that day was chopping up adder I'd found in my greenhouse. It had gone there twice before to keep warm, no doubt, but you can't have snakes lying on top of the pumpkins and squashing them, can you? Well, I'd found it there, and I put it out in the garden, but third time's unlucky, I say. And I needed some venom and snake skin for a batch of wart remover. I tend to get bothered by warts these days. Maybe it's all the work I do with toads. So there I am, minding my own business, when I hear this funny sort of noise outside. Like a sort of crackling, crunchy sound. Now, before I go on, I'd better explain that I live in Stinky Wood. Called that account of me family, what goes back generations it do. They used to keep chickens for their eggs. And eggs, of course, are best eaten after they've been matured for at least 6 months. The taste and smell are delicious, I can tell you. Also, my house, well, cottage really, is made out of gingerbread. This is because it was built by my great-great-grandmother, who mistook a huge pile of biscuits someone had fly-tipped in a nearby lane. Thought it was bricks, she did. So, back to what I was telling you. When I peered out the front window, what did I see but these two kids? Boy and a girl, about 10 or 11 years old, I guess. And so much alike, they had to be brother and sister. And do you know what they were doing? They were breaking off bits of my home and eating them. Well, I ask you, what do you think of that? So out I goes, all nice and smarmy-like. Didn't want little beggars, little silly little children to get away with it. Invites them in, I did, and gives them a nice tea of ladies' fingers, parson's nose, and a handful of bananas. Then, while they were busy tucking in, I grabbed the little bite blighters and popped them in the chicken run and locked the door while I thought what to do with them. I hadn't had a decent meal for weeks, not since the local snails had been scoffed by that pesky badger, and Tawny, my pet owl, refuses to supply him with the pellets. Taste of them owl pellets are, go well with mash and hedgehog gravy. Any road, I kept these juvenile delinquents under lock and key. Didn't mistreat them, no indeed, I fattened them up, I did. Animal cracker doorstops, cat's tom cookie doorknobs, gingerbread men, angel cake chimney pots, chocolate favoured brownies. Got them brownies when they were camping in the woods last year. Butterfly cake. Now these can be a bit hard to catch, you know, so I wasn't going to give the kids that unless for a big treat, which they deserve now if they were going to get nice and fat. My eyesight's not what it used to be, all these years spent living in a dark wood. So each day I'd get them to stick their finger through the mesh of the chicken run, but they never seemed to put any weight. Found out later they'd been poking stick out. And I thought it was their fingers, little blighters. Like I said, you can't trust nobody these days. In the end, I was so famished, I got a nice hot fire going and got the little tykes out, all ready to put them in at 350 degrees. The boy, Hansel the girl called him. She was Gretel, it seems. I asked what sort of names are them. Now, I've got a lovely name. Runs in the family for generations. What is it, you ask? Ain't telling you. The witch tells a human her names and she loses her powers. To get back to me story, this Hansel comes out of the run, followed closely by Gretel. All nice and quiet and shy they was, and pretending to be frightened. But then, as I turn me back to poke up the fire, I feel this almighty push in my back. And that did hurt. It's never been the same since the huntsman nearly did for me when I was disguised as a good deer. So there's me in agony and being pushed into the blasted fire. But at this second, thank goodness, or I wouldn't be here to tell the tale, the little beggars took flight and ran. Out of the door, down the path, they didn't even stop to close the gate. Well, that just shows what sort of manners their parents didn't teach them. Me? Oh, I managed to pull myself back out of the flames just in time. And I've got some amazing Newton nose-dropping potion that does wonders for burns. I heard rumours that those kids were bragging that they'd burnt me to death. But just in case anybody should come looking, I keep a low profile. After all, I'm only a poor old soul who wouldn't do nobody no harm. Bye-bye.
Uncertain times, or the world's gone crazy. It always was. Can I have a Corona, please? Strawberry or raspberry, dear? You wouldn't ask for that, no. I will start each paragraph with a word. If you have a pen, please write it down. You will see a word appearing down the left-hand side of what you have written. Nauta. Calm. Calm? You've got to be crazy if you think that's an option. Being in close proximity with my dearest for weeks. I'm used to being on my own. Odd. Odd. You think it's obligatory? It is. You think it's without its limitations? Darn right. Rabbits. Rabbits in the field next to the cottage have more freedom. Running round the grass with their randy dispositions. Oboe. Oboe playing, so they say, is relaxing. Not to me. I haven't got an oboe. And I certainly haven't got the breath to blow it. Naughty. Naughty thoughts keep flooding through my mind. Tom Jones singing Kiss. Ah. All should listen to the words and facial expression. The voice. Val doesn't have the answers to the current situation. I wish to hell I did. India, so sultry. Wanted to visit there, ride an elephant, wear a sari. Warmth, spices, people. Rulers, idiots that can't be named, certainly not poor. Using the cream of our society, teachers, nurses, doctors, and so many more. Useful. Useful. Be useful if only on the phone. You can rid them of their fears by talking to someone. Silently. Silently show you're above it all. Smile. Smile it round the world. It's infectious and goes a long, long way. Don't go robbing shells. That's for a turd. Keep your distance. Don't be a nerd. A smile doesn't cost, nor does a wave. But for somebody needing it, you can pull them out their cave. My name is Val. I'm a bit mad. I wish you a healthy return to normality, whatever that is for you. But there's no fun in being normal. Just keep safe. Back to normal service now.
Hi, it's Emily Baker here. Sorry I can't be with you in person to accept this award. I'm currently in Los Angeles filming Baywatch 2, the sequel. Pamela Anderson wouldn't do it for that money, and as I was her body double in the original, obviously natural choice. Not content with it flicking my physical piano playing on with you a couple of months ago, sorry about that, I'm now going to share with you some virtual piano playing, and as my comedy hero Eric Morecambe once said, I think you'll find they are the right notes, but not necessarily in the right order. Love you all, stay safe, see you soon, enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Muppet Show with special guest Miss Emily Baker.
Featuring Felix Subway.
It's time to play the music. It's time to light the light. It's time to meet the Muppets on the Muppet Show tonight. It's time to put on makeup. It's time to
dress up right. It's time to raise the curtain on the Muppet Show tonight. Why do we always come here? Oh, guess we'll never know. It's like a kind of torture just to have to watch the show. And now let's get things started. And now let's get things started. Why don't you get things started? It's time to get things started on the most sensational, celebrational, egg and mushroom, epilapino show!
Have you ever desired an instant whipped cream savoury garnish for your lasagna? Well, here it is! Emily's whipped cream savoury lasagna, available in pistachio, paprika, anchovy, and why not try it at prawn and oregano combo?
Hurry, while stocks last. It's yummy for your tummy, dummy.
Shalom, my friends. Shalom, my friends. Shalom, shalom. Till we meet again, till we meet again. Shalom, shalom. Shalom, my friends. Shalom, my friends. Shalom, shalom. Till we meet again, till we meet again. Shalom, shalom. Shalom, my friends. Shalom, my friends. Shalom, shalom. Till we meet again, till we meet again. Shalom, shalom.
From the unpublished translation of my 2012 book, Nomos, Strömsholms Vägen 21, Burio. I recur, recur, recourse to it always. It has to be an epicenter. I choose it. I retrace the tire tracks over supermarket beer cans, the scent of tar, scent of tar, VHS bought at British Petroleum, crop the firewood, reap the firewood. The dreams always took place in a clear fell, the song sung, solitary catalogues, journals, journals. One could read anything. I could read, spill the seed, cottage red purity, Paris burger, wheats and coffee, the thin bread, the thinner walls, with knife, innards of fish, the scent of purgatives, of mew, of the sea always, to secretly smoke into the furnace, or else there would be no hot water, the piping relegated all over the house, the taste of quinine, of summer, gunpowder, of mosquitoes, of summer mornings, winter games, gasoline, burnout, berries plucked on the fell, on the plot, amongst the rocks, my sister with me. 9 out of 10, 10 out of 10 standing. You cannot outgrow your achievements. The light, consciously astray, sheep in the creek, moose on the hill, The forest roads never ended. They passed unheeded. They changed from dreams into memories of dreams.
This is By and By. Push me through this corridor of very shiny floors. Just how many bags now, just how many doors. At night along the corridor I hear the softest shuffling feet. It's my funky friend the dinosaur, and he's missing all the mates he used to meet by and by. By and by, I check through this turnstile. Can I get a ride with you? So many times I tried to fly, my arms are getting tired. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind, but that question's just crawling along the ground. Bye, 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 bye. Tried so many faces to find the one I like. I hold it tight and I wait for the wind to change. Takes so long, my face grows long, so tired now, so disappointed. Put away my mirror, put away my toys, yeah, yeah, yeah. By and by, by and by. Cry this lullaby, smile this moment goodbye, frown this day down, I grin this broken clown. Pain but let it be in the past each day. Oh God, let it last in anger. Well, I don't wanna be your friend, just let me care. Just let me care. Funky friend the dinosaur, he's missing all the mates he used to meet. Thank you.
I thought spring came early this year, the mild winter, the abundance of rain. It gave some of us the sense of a good year to come, as flowers bloomed and the beauty of the world spread around us. Yet, an unseen evil was journeying around the globe, on this earth that we all call home. A 2020 vision in the year 2020 does not help, as the population of each country is struck down. The key dates in our history are based on place names and years of wars and catastrophes. The battle that we face now does not include the bow, gunpowder, cannon, or any gun, pistol, or rifle known as a firearm. Sword, rapier, a knife does not have the swiftness or sharpness for this enemy. Wars rely on crowds of armies, of a force prepared to advance, to infiltrate, to disarray. This evil is known as COVID-19. Its number is infinite. It becomes more infectious and multiplies as we stand near to each other. Unity we must have, but with a good space between our bodies. In this day and age, in the 21st century, we have the technology to communicate and be safe. We must use it. We have the knowledge to fight COVID-19. We must use it. We, the ordinary people, need to support those who have the ability to fight the sickness. We must do so. By keeping our distance from each other, we do our part. Yet, we and those on the front line need something precious that the passing of each day just cannot give us. That is extra time. Time is one of the most precious things in life. It can take a lifetime to appreciate it. We waste time in doing unimportant things. We waste to gain material that we do not necessarily give us peace of mind. We wasted by not embracing those around us more, especially our kith and kin. We wasted by not being kinder to our neighbour, whether they live near or far away. Each day now, we are reminded that our minds must adjust more to this new pandemic. As I write at the end of March, no one knows the outcome, the end game. How long will it last? How many will die? How will it change those of us who live, in mind and in body? What will the future mean and hold? What will it give us? How will we live? God has taken us by the shoulders and given us a good shake. If we learn one thing today, it is to listen before we act.
Hello all at Spoken Word Saturday. This is recorded on Monday the 6th of April, and after last night's rain, it's soft and sunny in the garden, and if there's a background sound, it's the birds singing in the trees. When I was at Spoken Word Saturday, gosh, a month ago, four very life-changing weeks ago, Jackie read her poem Oil Man about her father. And I was familiar with the poem and had been thinking, oh, yes, I could write one about my dad on a similar basis. And I suppose the coronavirus catastrophe has really pushed me into the poem that I'm going to read for you shortly. My dad was a GP in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, bit of the 90s in Hereford West in Pembrokeshire, and he died about 3 years ago. And I asked an old friend of Dad's, his old partner, what he would have made in his working life of the situation that we're in now. And Alan said he would have just got on with it. I thought, yeah, he would have just got on with it. So this is for Dad and for all of my former colleagues in the NHS, because I used to work in public health at what I thought was not the sharp end of the business at all. But now they're very much at the sharp end in terms of our epidemiological understanding of COVID-19 and advising on measures to prevent and deal with the outbreak. So this is for my dad and for my old friends in public health. Physician. No one understood patients like he did. He sat there, in his consulting room, on the telephone, beside a bed, listening. He always knew. He knew what to do, knew what to say, knew when to say it, knew how to say it. He was the doctor. They came from miles to see him in his surgery, from Tancredston, Natshook, Roos Ferry Farm. They called him out to theirs every night, one weekend in four as well. And he went, whatever the weather, past Newgale's Pebble Ridge in storms, in winter with snow chains fixed by Mr. Pope, who ran the garage Dad called the Vatican. His cool, slender hands, nails manicured, tilted a head, felt a brow, massaged a neck for swollen glands, made notes in always legible copperplate. Pungent aromas, Wright's coal tar, ether, Yardley's English lavender brilliantine, the one he called green grease. These scented his days, smoothed his patient's worries. He wore surgery smart for work, a navy blue suit, chinos and jacket in later years, sleeve garters to hold up his shirt cuffs, a silk liberty tie, a coloured square hanky in top pocket. He spent his down days on his knees in the soggy peat of Dowrog or Brimberian, his horoscope swapped for the botanist's lens, training his gentle fingers through the geek green, while he and Keeble Martin keyed out orchid, moss and lichen. Now, look at that. He pencil-tapped attention. Hours to detail the secrets of plants, his to know the trials of his patients' lives. Jochen Bauer, thank you very much.
Four candles burnt in a room. The first candle spoke. I am peace, it said. But nobody keeps me anymore, so why keep burning? The room grew darker. The second candle spoke. I am faith, it said. But nobody believes in me anymore. So why keep burning? The room grew darker. The third candle spoke. I am love, it said. But nobody believes in me anymore, so why keep burning? The room grew darker. And a child walked into the room. It said, why is this room so dark? Why are there four candles, yet only one is burning? The fourth candle spoke. Do not cry, my child, it said. But take me and use me to light the other candles. Fourth candle spoke again, it said, I am hope.
Alfie Top Dog, July, my birthday month. Alfo's boy, you left me behind on earth. The great jolly July, jolly no more. Heart-wrenching waves of relentless grief. I understand, Cariad, but God, it hurts, Alfos. The waves less frequent or ferocious, and I can now look at your photograph once more, but not for too long. It's okay, Alfie. I am healing in acceptance, as your tenacious terrier outlook rubbed off on me. My bundle of joy, I pledged to continue our good work. Healing tears, thank you. But it's time to celebrate humanity at its best, with no delusional perfectionist outlook, but celebrating our beautiful imperfections. My innocent playfulness and belly-aching laughter rekindled. I still have the dirtiest laugh in town. Alfie the Great, with your spirit beside me, a beacon of light that will never be extinguished. Mother Earth, nature, and the animal kingdom, our wise guides, if we would only be silent in stillness to reflect and be enriched with wisdom. Hope lights the way if we dare to believe.
I just heard a Meggie Royer poem that stopped me dead in my tracks. It hit my heart and halted my breath and rewound my memory back. The morning after I killed myself, in its simplicity, is so strong. It transported me back to my suicidal thought after my whole world had gone wrong. What if I'd actually done it, performed and executed my thought? Think of all the things I would have missed and all the grief the end would have brought. I would no longer see the sun rise or set, or gaze in awe at the silvery moon, or guess shapes in the clouds as they floated by, because I would have been gone too soon. No more time to just sit and ponder, nor meditate in the peace of the quiet, bend and stretch my body in yoga, or wonder whether I should go on a diet. I wouldn't have broken an arrow with my neck, nor walked over extremely hot coals, or realised that everything is energy, nor achieved a single one of my goals. I would never have sung on the stage, nor believed that I ever could, and I would never have become a tree hugger each time I walked through the wood. I wouldn't have had any more fun, or know what pottery clays like to hold, or laughed when it fell off the wheel, or known what it would be like to get old. I wouldn't have met my nephews and niece, felt their soft downy heads with my finger, or seen them grow up over the years because I decided to no longer linger. I would never have written any poems or discovered that I do have a voice, or realised that our journey has a start and an end, and in between that we all have a choice. I would never have seen this virus appear and wonder what living really means, to look at my reflection in the mirror and decide I must follow my dreams. Lately, my growth has accelerated as a result of me writing my book. It's uncovered feelings buried deeply, and I'm ready now to do more than just look. If I'd gone, I wouldn't have found a new passion and special people who are giving me wings to bring my words out into the open. I'm so grateful to have unearthed these things. I suppose my recovery truly began the second I chose to stay on the road. An awakening seemed to occur within, though it appeared to be written in code. So each day is uncovering so much. It's interesting, exciting, and more. And I'm so looking forward to the rest of my life and revealing who I am at my core. Meggie's poem hit me right between the eyes and brought up many a tear, because that day I did not kill myself, and I am overjoyed that I am still here. Thank you.
Helen May Williams. From a letter found in my mother's belongings after her death. Postmarked Blundell Sands, Liverpool, 9:30 a.m., 20th June 1939. Date, 17th June 1939. Dear June, it is the time of haymaking, but the rain hinders it. And so the grass still stands full of poppies and campion and blue rocket and lots of other flowers. I cannot prevent myself from thinking of you. though I do not look upon your face. Michael. P.S. Excuse the ink. It has no strength of character. Harbingers of Autumn. A small child stands in the doorway, cranes her neck, scans the chill horizon for wisps, then plumes of smoke. Clouds flock the evening sky, begin to detach themselves, little atavistic bands loud above her head. The sound of rusty bicycles heading northwest. V-shapes emerge, shift and regroup above the mansard roof. Darkening tracks fill the upper atmosphere, wave upon wave, veering unerringly to wetland mere, tipping the air from out their wings, whiffling, then dropping down to the nighttime lagoon. October, since 10,000 years. Diolch yn fawr.
I'm going to read three poems. The first two are older poems of mine, both love letters. One is to my wife Diane, one is to my friend Ines, and both are about that intimacy that we still experience through poetry when we're so far apart from each other. So for Di, coming home. I have found your absence in the gentleness between moments. I have heard your gaze in the brown warmth of Irish sun. I dreamed you real in medieval verse, then surrendered my passion to you in every tongue syllable offered to the bawdy Atlantic. In the soft cloud vapoured on the sky by Icarus' fall, I prayed your slender limbs and spine. I will curve and line you with my palms. I will kiss your land undone, breathe every touch of cotton and yarn from your skinscape. Shiver you, tongue-tip sentenced, vowel every rose-blood flesh, heart-blood stiffened by my song of angels' worship, delicately echoing the rolling white force that mists tremor with a summer's heaveth. And for Ines, letter. I am not waiting, for there is no time, no season. Like Doctor Who, we warp the space-time continuum, spun Tronos hours round a spindle called present. In great waters, I am never lost. I am threaded to the shore where my words shape your body. Friendship is immediate and dialogical, a clumsy undressing of toughened skins. You stripped me later with an empathy so intense, it filled space and excluded place. Passion pared away epidermal grip, slowly laughter sliced another layer, and the careful scalpel of understanding bared me further. I bore you baptismal from the Somon, marking our creative communion. Alenteo fingers fashioned waxen wings, intimacy, razor sharp, skinned me. Your heartbeat makes me cry. You ignited the very salt in me, cleansing energies, raw, open, vulnerable, but burning. I demand your purity and integrity like oxygen. And certainties we share like kisses. Your touch is unknown. Yet when I see your smile again, you will cradle my embryonic soul in your virgin palms. Defenseless, but safe from when or where. And once all is dissected with these beautiful instruments, what is left but love? And for the poets, I have one more. A short one from R.S. Thompson called Legend. I went up the holy mountain, thinking to be at dawn a poet or a dead man, but not mad, not mad. I was already that. I came down from the mountain where the tempter had offered, in exchange for my poetry, the kingdom of this world. My insanity saved me. May your insanity save you all. Young Bo, thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Carl. I would like to share my poetry. Guitar Man Promenade. I saw you playing your tune by the promenade. Blues was the music you shared and displayed. Your fingers quick to respond to the ever-changing strings. The sisters of soul deep inside you still swings. You smile with an inner peace that connects you to the past. Your life shared by many, but now you have become an outcast. Lonely you may be, but we all know music has set you free. You strum with ease, you close your eyes. A lifetime of memories passes by. The taste of tobacco touches your lips as you smoke. You're relying on loose change to fill the pockets of broke. You ride the rhythm of life until you can't play no more. The Guitar Man Promenade lives on in our hearts and soul for us to explore. Mr. Ed. Walking quietly down the country lane, I listen in silence and await the crowing of Mr. Ed. Drumming powerful his wings, I heard from a distance. Mr. Ed has landed in a field of morning blanket. I called out to my friend to give him his daily offering. His head pops up over the satin dew with frantic movements of joy. Leaning on the old rusty gate, waiting patiently to greet him, I see shades of golden brown and sunset red, with splashes of emerald green approaching proudly like a soldier on patrol. He extends his thrusting neck to retrieve his daily delights of golden corn. All his Moorish fodder has been eaten at the speed of light, only leaving lifeless husks behind for the winter winds to carry them on a never-ending journey through the countryside. Time has come to say goodbye until the next time to feed my feathered friend, Mr. Red.
Sometimes in the morning I can hear it breathing, sharp and cold in the dawning of spring, so close it could be standing at my side. Sometimes in the morning I can hear it breathing. Sometimes in the morning I can hear its words, words never spoken, emptied by time and despair. Sometimes in the morning I can hear its words, put back together from the pieces that were left. Sometimes in the morning I can breathe in its smell of heather and grass, of sap and resin. Sometimes I can breathe in its smell of animals, of ferns, of tree and leaf. Sometimes I can feel it in the wind, the breath of the future, through fields of injured dreams and forests of illusion, of false dawns and broken promises. Still I feel it in the wind, the breath of the future. What should I call it? What is its name? It is love. It is justice. It is peace. Sometimes it is standing by my side in the morning. Sometimes in the morning I can hear it breathing. Who knew the journey would be so strange? The paths so hard, so cold and unrelenting. The nights so long, the days suffused with pain. Good luck so brief and bad luck so unbending. Who knew how many comrades we would lose? How many lovers swallowed up by time? Friends cast adrift beneath a harvest moon. old debts called in and new ones paid in kind. Who knew that all we ever knew would change? To fail would be the same as to succeed. And yet that far beneath the mountain range, a million stars lay strewn beneath our feet. Who knew all this before we started out? Before we crossed the wild and singing seas? Before we burned our bridges and our boats to take our chances with heaven's refugees?
Do you see the same sky as me? Even when we're in different places, and you put on the kettle for tea and look out of your window, and I put water in the saucepan for eggs and peer out of the kitchen door. Even when we're right beside each other, and I can feel the crackle of your jacket, smell your smokiness, and see the shape of your silhouette as evening starts to hasten. Do you see different things from me? Do you look for the plumes of white cloud streaked across the ocean of blue and analyze the strange shapes? Do you see gradations in the blue? Or watch for planes and UFOs? Do you wait for orange and pink stripes to seep across the horizon and work out the spiritual significance of sunshine melting into darkness? Do you ponder the nature of water vapour and ice crystals, or the times when you slept on a rooftop in Marrakesh, looking at a million dots? Do you notice the lampposts and rooftops and tops of cars, or wait for the moon to appear, silver white suspended? Do you hear the whisper of the leaves in the trees, or the cawing of gulls? Do you notice the motorbike revving up and the teenagers shouting? Is your aim to capture it all in the frame of your mobile phone and send it to Facebook friends, old and new, to share it around? Or do you, like me, sometimes remember the times when it hurts so much, a luxury too hard to bear, to look upwards? The curb, the pavement stones, the litter and the dust, our feet pounding, out our despair in South London, South England, South Wales streets. Stars ignored, sunsets missed, impossible to absorb. The misery of grinding work, of despair and loneliness endured, our eyes kept firmly on the ground. Something changed. We changed. We rebuilt. We met. We found the courage to look up again. To dare to let in the vastness, to be suffused by light and to feel the breeze on our faces. Do you feel, like me now, that every last drop of pleasure must be drunk before night falls forever, and the sound of the neighbour's grandchildren tells us that another generation is coming, for whom the horizon seem promising, who want their own chance at skies that we have shared, skies which will link us at death's hour, which will become theirs, our stewardship over.
I wrote this poem on the 25th of March, 2 days after the UK government ordered the population to stay at home, except for essential journeys, because of the pandemic. Dam burst. Drape a shawl around your heart and catch each precious falling part. Thank you.
bitter and better. I don't think fuck you when I see a red car anymore. It's funny how the universe sends us signs, mirrors, if you will. The first three letters to your name were the start of danger. I don't use blame as an excuse anymore. We are who we are, no less, no more. I yearned for you like the desert yearns for water. But I found that it was me who I was missing. Lost in your jungle of illusion, so deluded even you believed everything that went down was healthy, was normal, but it wasn't. We were toxic, like the West. The times I tried so hard, clinging to you like the aftermath of a nuclear bomb, but I'm not bitter. I churned the data up, I cleansed myself, I healed my tar gunk of self-loathing up with intense love and light. I found that it wasn't that I was not good enough, it's the fact that I shined too bright, flooding your darkness, no corner left unilluminated. Like a sun shining through the dark forested leaves. You may have left me in ruins, but I built up my castle. And now I rule as a queen.
I hope you enjoyed that. Bonnie and I certainly did. Thank you so much for sending in your offerings. I miss you lots. And it won't be long till we're all together again in the wonderful Furnace Fach. Take care, stay healthy. Ta-ta for now.